Now to a great Australian who is living the Hollywood dream. Karl Schmid is an entertainment reporter for a major American television network. But for a decade, Karl kept a secret, one which could have ended his career. You see, Karl is HIV-positive, and earlier this year, he put that fear behind him and went public with his status. Karl is home for Christmas, and we are thrilled that he's joining us here on the Studio 10 panel this morning. Karl, welcome. How are you?
I'm good, and look how summery and lovely you all look. And what a good-looking studio audience too, might I just say.
Yes.
Good morning, everyone.
Karl, we mentioned in that intro there that for a decade you kept a secret, one which could have ended your career. Mm. Why would it have ended your career?
Well, you know, that's a very good question. And in 2018, it shouldn't have ended
yes.
my career, but there is so much stigma around HIV. It still exists. And I think for a lot of people, especially in Australia, when we hear HIV/AIDS, we think of those Grim Reaper ads that ran for such a short period. They were actually yanked off the air back in the 80s because they're so horrific. But that's largely what people remember. And the reality is, it's 2018 now. So the face of HIV has changed. This is what HIV looks
because
like in 2018.
It used to be a death sentence. No cure, people didn't understand it in the early 80s. And as we have fast-forwarded, there are new drugs available. But it was a death sentence.
Absolutely it was. And I think it was important back then. They needed to scare the bejesus out of somebody. Because no one quite knew what it was. Government officials weren't talking about it. The President of the United States certainly wasn't mentioning it. But we haven't really had a new conversation since. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of where I come into the frame these days. I didn't know this was going to happen. I honestly, a friend of mine took a photo of me. I thought, I look quite good in this picture. I'll post it on Instagram. And I really didn't think anyone outside my immediate social circle, and maybe those who I work with at ABC in the United States, would say anything. And within 24 hours, this thing went kaboom, and here I am 9 months later, very happily sitting here at Studio 10 with you guys talking about it.
So why aren't you sick?
I'm not sick because every morning, along with my turmeric pill, which is very Hollywood,
turmeric anti-inflammatory.
Yes, and my multivitamin. I take one tablet every morning, and that gets my viral load so suppressed in my body that it's undetectable. So essentially, it's really, in a way, it's there, but it's not there. And being undetectable means there is zero risk of me being able to transmit the virus sexually to another partner. The World Health Organization has come out, the CDC and America Centers for Disease Control. Even here in Australia, a health minister mentioned on World AIDS Day this messaging, U equals U, undetectable equals untransmittable. And so science has shown over hundreds of thousands of sexual acts between men who have sex with men, heterosexual couples, hundreds of thousands between an HIV-positive undetectable person and a negative person, zero transmission. So these have been going on since before 2000.
Karl, I'm interested, when you were first diagnosed, you wouldn't have known all of that because you wouldn't have been researching into it. What was your initial reaction? Were you still of the opinion, of the impression that this could be a death sentence?
Not so much that it could be a death sentence. When I was first diagnosed, I was in London at the time, working in London at the time, and the two things that went off immediately in my head as I had to walk back from the clinic to my office and go back to work was, one, it felt like a digital countdown clock had started over my head.
Really?
And the other thing was, oh, my goodness, how am I going to... I have really let my parents down. Because I think for... You know, parents, it's one thing to have to deal with or accept or, you know, a child who comes out. And then I think, and again, because of the stigma, I think it's fair to say that a lot of parents hear that their son is gay and a lot of people still go, he's going to get AIDS, because that's what everyone associates. And so that was, and it's all stigma-based.
But what was your parents' reaction when you told them? Did they think that was what was going to happen to you?
I don't think so. Certainly we didn't have that conversation. I mean, obviously it's shocking, but I've said this before. I think anyone who goes through any kind of diagnosis, whether it's an HIV or cancer, it's often the family and friends around who suffer more in a way because as the person who's dealing with it, you go, OK, I have to deal with it, so what do we do? You can't afford to sit around and wallow. And I really haven't. But what's interesting about this whole experience for me is that, you know, I've been living... By the time I disclosed in March publicly, which I didn't think was going to be a big deal, I was open with it, friends and family and stuff. But I didn't realise the level of internalised stigma that I have. And in the last 9 months of being open and talking about it, you know, I used to make silly kind of jokes. And in all honesty, in my mind, I thought I was making jokes. I'm damaged goods. You're not going to want me now because why would you want this damaged goods? But I said it as a sort of... I'm a bit of a cheeky boy and I'm a bit smart aleck. I didn't come to realise until the last few months that actually somewhere buried deep in the back of my head, I was believing that.
Yeah.
So it's not only the stigma that we face in the everyday public, especially, I found, amongst the gay community, which shocks me.
Really?
Oh, yeah, but the internalised stigma. So normalising those three letters and the symbol, having a conversation, starting to talk about it. Look, it's a chronic illness. Mm. It's really... no different to having diabetes or any of these other chronic... It really isn't, especially with the messaging of you equals you. I can't transmit it to anyone. There's no need to be frightened of me because of three letters and a symbol.
Yeah. Can I talk about... You mentioned the photo. Mm. And can we look a little bit at the photo and the Facebook post where...
Look how handsome he is.
Yeah.
If you do say so yourself.
And by the way, that T-shirt I'm wearing, the AIDS Memorial, if you don't already follow the AIDS Memorial on Instagram, it's a wonderful Instagram feed that helps us remember and celebrate people we lost way too soon back in the horrible days.
And this is what you posted with it. I'm me, I'm just like you, I have a big heart and I want to be loved and accepted. You can't make everybody happy, but you can make you happy. Labels are things that come and go, but your dignity and who you are is what defines you. I'm Karl Schmid and I'm an HIV-positive man. That's where it all... That's the one that went...
Kaboom.
Ironically viral.
Yes. Yeah, that's the one. And as I said, I thought it was somewhat of a cute photo of
it. Yeah. It is.
And my best friend, we'd been out for happy hour, and my best friend came back to my place. We had another couple of drinks, and as he was leaving, he said that night, don't do anything stupid tonight. And I think he thought I was going to go out and be crazy. And then the next morning, I mean, this thing, I had no idea. It took off. And by lunchtime, the Hollywood Reporter had picked it up, Daily Mail, Entertainment Tonight. It's been in press all over Europe. And my friend went, I told you not to do anything stupid.
Has PrEP, the drug to suppress your...
PrEP is what you take if you're not HIV positive, but it's a similar drug to what I take.
Has that changed the gay community?
Mm. Yeah, I think it has because, and again, all of my friends in Los Angeles... negative friends take PrEP.
Explain what PrEP is.
So PrEP it's a contraceptive. It's a form of the HIV drug I take, but in a lesser form. But it is proven that if you take this drug and every day and soon to be really rolled out, the PrEP on demand, which means, you know, you can sort of take it for 4 days.
You can never contract AIDS or HIV if you take this drug?
If you take PrEP... Well, listen, no scientist is ever going to say never because they can't test everyone. But of the tests they've done, I think in the case of PrEP... And by the way, I'm not a doctor, I'm not a scientist, so please don't start tweeting me if I've said something slightly not 100% correct.
But that's the premise of it.
But the premise, it's a contraceptive, much like the pill is for women.
Karl, I just wanted... You were talking about having a new conversation. Yep. I grew up in the era, as many of us did, with the Grim Reaper, which scared all of us and achieved extraordinary results in basically dramatically reducing the STI incidence in Australia and also HIV and AIDS. It basically won the war and we were seen right around the world as being an extraordinary case.
Even though they yanked that commercial off the air because it was so... Anyway,
confronting. But, but I was talking to you earlier about starting this new conversation where you say it's not... You shouldn't say people are having protected or unprotected sex. You say condomless
sex.
So I think a big issue now in Australia is seeing the dramatic increase in STI infection in a lot of young men and women, heterosexual, and also in the gay community. Is that a conversation we need to have?
Of course it's a conversation we need to have. And yes, but just because there is PrEP and just because I am undetectable, thus untransferable of the HIV virus, one still has to be responsible for their sexual health. I mean, if you're a sexually active person, good luck, well done, I'm jealous. But if it's going on a lot, you should go and get tested a lot. And we, again, the stigmas are, exist. A lot of people, I don't want to know about it, I don't want to deal with it. What if I have AIDS, which, by the way, you don't get AIDS, you get HIV. But in regards to other STIs, look, yeah, be responsible, but that means knowing your sexual health status. Mm. Go and get tested, people.
These developments come about as a result of research, and we know that there's been an incredible amount of fundraising going on around the world. Elton John comes to mind. Yeah. He has raised millions and millions of dollars, and it just goes to show how amazing research is that we're now at this stage. When you're trying to spread the word like this, what does the diagnosis of someone like Charlie Sheen do for the cause?
I knew this question was coming. I knew you'd ask it, Angela Bishop. Look, my stance on the Charlie Sheen, because I get asked this a lot. If you're a fan of Charlie Sheen's, if you like Charlie and what he does, then I think this is a good thing. If you're not a fan of Charlie Sheen's, you're going to hate it and probably get mad anyway. But the way I see it, whatever gets us talking about HIV in a normal way, again, to destigmatize, to make those three letters and a symbol less scary for people, I think the better. It's all about starting a conversation, which you all do so well here on Studio.